As Vice Chancellor of the University, I declare this congregation open for the conferring of degrees by the authority of the Senate and the Council. Will you please be seated? Lord Lieutenant, my Lord Bishop, High Sheriff of Leicestershire, High Sheriff of Rutland, Chairman of Leicestershire County Council, civic guests, parents, friends, and graduands. I am delighted to welcome you all to this degree congregation. It is a celebration for all those who graduate today. We celebrate your many achievements that culminate in the award of a degree from a major international research and teaching-led university. At these degree congregations, we also award honorary degrees for very distinguished work. And it is a great pleasure to invite in due course the public orator to introduce a figure who is world-renowned. Indeed, when the name came before the Honorary Degrees Board, it was an absolute standout choice that this university would itself consider it a great honour if Archbishop Desmond Tutu agreed to accept a degree from us. It is our great good fortune and our honour that the Archbishop did decide to do this, and also not only to accept the degree, but to join us here in Leicester this afternoon. I know that many people have been very excited at the prospect of Archbishop Tutu coming to the university, and there's been a huge amount of excitement over the last two or three days because people knew that they would have the opportunity to meet him, if only for a short time. In that respect, we hope that while this is the first occasion that Archbishop Tutu has visited the university, that it won't be the last. And we indeed have already invited him to give a university public lecture in 2012. But at this stage, I will hand over to the public orator, who I now invite forward.
Desmond Tutu is by profession the Emeritus Archbishop of Cape Town, by conviction a servant of his God and his country, and by his actions a champion of the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and the voiceless people of the world. Within the Church, he takes the view that its global leader should not be chosen by the British Prime Minister, that Anglicans should not discriminate against homosexuals, and that those parts of the Bible that endorse slavery or stipulate that women should not speak in churches should be quietly set aside. Beyond the Church, though always informed by his Christian convictions, he has played a central role in the ending of apartheid. He has condemned homophobia as a crime against humanity comparable to apartheid. He has championed the human rights of women, especially in the African context, and he has been active as a public health campaigner and as a champion of peace and of climate change awareness. The two diseases that are most prominent in South Africa and that will engage the lives of some of the medical doctors and scientists graduating today are TB and HIV/AIDS. If I may use Dr. Tutu's own words to address you, those who work to care for people suffering from AIDS and TB are wiping a tear from God's eye. In the case of TB, which Desmond Tutu suffered as a young man, his passion for eradication is embodied in the research conducted at the Desmond Tutu TB Center at Stellenbosch University, in the hospital on that campus, and in his patronage of the UK charity TB Alert. In the case of HIV/AIDS, Dr. Tutu is patron of the Desmond Tutu HIV Foundation, honorary chairman of the Global AIDS Alliance. He has also been an outspoken opponent of senior figures in South Africa who deny the link between HIV and AIDS. Desmond Tutu is now a global figure, and that standing is perhaps best represented by his position as chairman of the Elders, an interventionist group of 12 former world leaders, including Kofi Annan, Nelson Mandela, Jimmy Carter, Mary Robinson, and in absentia, Aung San Suu Kyi. This global standing is an unlikely outcome for a man whose life began almost 80 years ago on the oppressed side of what was to become the apartheid divide. He grew up in a small gold mining town in the Transvaal, where his father was a teacher and his mother was a cook and cleaner at a school for the blind. Young Desmond's first profession was teaching, which he abandoned after the Bantu Education Act, which enforced separation of races in all educational institutions. He then turned to the church, a decision influenced by his admiration for Trevor Huddleston, who, when Desmond was young, had raised his hat in respect as he greeted Desmond's mother. Desmond Tutu trained as a clergyman in South Africa and then in London. He served as a parish priest and in 1975 became the first black Anglican dean of Johannesburg. A year later, Soweto erupted in righteous violence, in the wake of which Desmond Tutu supported the economic boycott of South Africa, including the disinvestment program that subverted the strength of the rand and so exerted real pressure for reform. Desmond Tutu was appointed Bishop of Lesotho and Secretary General of the South African Council of Churches, and in this latter role, he brought many churches beyond the Anglican Communion into the struggle against apartheid. In 1986, he became Archbishop of Cape Town and Primate of the Church of the Province of South Africa. These positions made him the most prominent advocate of the view that apartheid was contrary to the will of God. In the end, apartheid fell, in part because of the leadership of Desmond Tutu. And in 1995, President Mandela appointed Dr. Tutu as chair of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. This commission may well have been the most demanding task of Desmond Tutu's life. Until it was established, the prevailing model at such historic moments was retribution, as exemplified by the Nuremberg trials and the denazification purges at the conclusion of World War II. Desmond Tutu rejected retribution in favor of the much more difficult aspiration to reconciliation, which naturally alienates those who seek revenge. This commission had a transformative effect on South Africa and has been the model for truth and reconciliation commissions in 19 other countries. In subsequent years, Desmond Tutu has assumed global roles but has continued to serve as the moral conscience of South Africa and, as Nelson Mandela put it, as the voice of the voiceless, sometimes strident, often tender, never afraid, and seldom without humour. We cannot claim to be the first to honour Desmond Tutu, in that he received the Nobel Peace Prize in 1984, the Albert Schweitzer Prize in 1986, the Gandhi Peace Prize in 2005, and the American Presidential Medal of Freedom in 2009. He has also received almost 100 honorary degrees. On this record, the honor that we are conferring today might seem surplus to requirements, but it is not, for two reasons. First, it was Dr. Tutu who coined the phrase Rainbow Nation to denote the ethnic mix of South Africa. And we in Leicester live in Britain's Rainbow City, the most diverse city in the nation. We stood with the people of South Africa during the long years of apartheid. And in 1986, we acquired a Nelson Mandela Park. Second, Dr. Tutu lives a life energized by Christian belief. And Leicester, in the words of our bishop, who is here today, is the most believing city in England. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, on the authority of the Senate and of the Council, I present to you Desmond Mpilo Tutu, that you may confer upon him the degree of Doctor of Letters.
I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Letters and welcome you among us. Many congratulations, thank and you. Thank you very much indeed.
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, Chairperson of the Board, all of you very distinguished persons. I can't remember all of those many titles, but all of you, wonderful people, and all of you, beautiful people, and you very, very, very clever people. It's a very, very great privilege to have been awarded this degree. You are obviously trying to see what you can do about changing the shape and size of my head. I wanted to become a doctor. I wasn't able to take up my place at medical school in the University of the Witwatersrand because we didn't have enough money for the fees. So this is the closest I've ever got to graduating as a doctor to come and be here with all of you. Congratulations to all of you who have done so splendidly well. I gather there are people who got first, and there are people who got upper second, and there might have been people who got something they call Desmond. Congratulations. And I do want to give a very warm tribute to the city of Leicester. As has been pointed out, you are really an icon of fellowship, committee, different faiths, different ethnicities, and you are an example to a world that is hungry for togetherness. You know, we have an extraordinary God who is omnipotent. But this God, extraordinarily, paradoxically, is also impotent. When someone is hungry, we don't see samosas floating down from heaven. If that hungry person is to be fed, this omnipotent God waits on us to be God's partners so that the miracle of feeding the hungry happens. You who are graduating today, I bid you dream. Be as idealistic as you can ever be. Dream God's dream. Dream as you go out into a world that is so unequal. Dream of a different world. Ours is a world where children die of preventable disease because they cannot afford fairly cheap vaccines, inoculations. Ours is a world where many go to bed hungry, when others wonder what they're going to do with their surpluses. Ours is a world crazy. We spend billions on what we call defense budgets, obscene amounts in what are really budgets of death, when a very, very, very small fraction we know would enable children everywhere in the world to have clean water to drink, enough food to eat, could have a decent home, have affordable health care. We know. God waits on you. You and you and you and you and you and you to dream God's dream of a world, a different kind of world, a compassionate world, a caring world, a sharing world. And God says, I have no one except you and you and you and you and you. And God says, help me. Help me. Please help me. Help me realize my dream.
Well, I know what you're all thinking. How do I follow that? Well, we follow it in the same tradition that we started, because degree ceremonies celebrate great success. And indeed, that's an example of huge success that we were delighted to honour this afternoon. But we're also celebrating a huge amount of success by each and every graduand in this room. Because one of the great things about degree ceremonies is at their very heart are people who have spent 3 years as undergraduates, 1 or 2 years or more as postgraduates, and in the case of those who qualify as doctors today, you've spent 5 years, unless, of course, you've done the graduate course, in which case it's 4 years of the MBCHB, together with 3 years before that taking some other degree programme. And it is you who are at the very heart of degree ceremonies, because we have the great pleasure of celebrating your success. Certainly, while you have been with us, the university has been successful in a number of different ways, and it has also developed and changed. We are now a community of 23,000 students, 3,800 staff, and we have a turnover of £260 million, a sum that has doubled over the last decade. We are, therefore, a big business with higher education at its heart. And in saying that, I mean that we have a set of values that we treasure in the academic community, and we must, despite all the circumstances, preserve. This academic year, the university has been placed in 17th position in The Guardian and 17th position in The Times. We are also placed 14th in The Times Higher Education magazine. As you can imagine, we treat all this very, very seriously. And I get an opportunity to review the data each year, and I've looked at it very carefully once again this year. And I can assure members of this degree congregation that in this particular year, the Times Higher Education magazine is the most comprehensive and reliable guide to English higher education. We are also proud of a range of other achievements. Demand for undergraduate places has gone up by 16%. We have increased our annual research income to £56 million. And we have continued to win many awards, including the Sconnell Library Design Award and an accolade for customer service excellence in the library. In terms of our estate, we have completed a £17 million refurbishment and transformation of the Percy G Students' Union building, which many of you will have now experienced, and it is also an award-winning building, as well as being an excellent venue for student affairs. We have recently completed a new £16 million medical sciences research building, and we are about to complete a 281 ensuite study bedroom complex at Nixon Court, which will be ready for the new intake this September. In addition, we will shortly be starting to build a new £5 million sports hall and swimming pool at Odeby, which you will be delighted to know will be available for alumni use. And we are also awaiting planning approvals to build a new £33 million medical building on University Road and a university conference centre on the College Hall site. Currently, we are reviewing our £1 billion development framework plan for the next 20 years. We're also creating plans for new research, new teaching programmes and new community links. These include a competition for up to 10 research professors who will set up world-class research centres here in the university. We have also developed a range of new master's courses, including banking and actuarial science, urban conservation, and media and public relations. We have strengthened our links with a number of primary and secondary schools, as well as a school for children with special needs. This all demonstrates that we are a dynamic 21st century university that provides high quality research and teaching alongside meeting widening participation benchmarks and providing an excellent student experience. It is these features that lead to a positive institutional ethos. But among all this success, I know that a major concern for many graduates and their parents is the impact of the economy on graduate employment. At this stage in your careers, I would urge you to hold your nerve. The degrees you have obtained are world-renowned and will contribute to your future achievements, but you will need to be flexible. This is the key to success in the current economic climate, and I would urge you to seek out every opportunity to develop your CV and continue to build on all your additional achievements recorded in your Higher Education Achievement Report, issued for the first time this year. You may also wish to consider postgraduate study, for which there are prospectuses in the foyer. And incidentally, in case parents, relatives, friends and visitors might feel a bit left out of it, I can assure you we would be delighted to sign you up this afternoon so that you too can be on your way to a degree ceremony in the De Montfort Hall. We are committed to the development of all our students' employability. The Graduate Success Programme provides a range of tailored career development services specially designed for you. Our graduate internship vacancies are advertised on the Career Service website, or look at the advert in the Guide to Graduation for more details. Another option is volunteering, an activity in which 1,600 Leicester students have been involved this year, with volunteers working on literacy programmes in schools, recycling and conservation projects, and work in local hospitals. We are very proud of your splendid record. It is a real contribution to the lives of the people of Leicester and Leicestershire. They will be forever indebted to you for the voluntary work that you have contributed. UK universities are world-renowned, but are undergoing major change as a consequence of introducing fees in 2012. Higher education will still be free at the point of entry, and no student will be required to pay for their education until after graduation, when they are earning in excess of £21,000 per annum. And at that stage, they will also have 30 years to repay their loan. This means that the average student will pay around £7 per week in order to pay off the loan. An excellent investment, in my view, for high-quality higher education. Universities offer new courses, new academic and cultural experiences, an opportunity to meet and develop new groups of friends, and a range of experiences and skill development that will last a lifetime. But higher education needs your support, and I hope on the basis of your experience in this university, you will wish to persuade the coalition government that higher education needs continued investment. At the University of Leicester, we start from a good position, with strong student demand, growing research activity, and sound finances. We see the benefits of progress made in the last few years. We are determined to rise to the challenge and to take new opportunities, to review our activities and work in new ways where we need to do so, as I want you, the graduates, parents, friends, and supporters of the university, to continue to be proud of us. This will be our aim. All universities make major contributions to a range of areas, to the communities in which they are located, to economic development, to sport, culture, and the arts. This year, the university is celebrating the 10th anniversary of its annual sculpture show in our botanic gardens. It includes 78 major sculptures from 64 sculptors, many of whom are nationally and internationally acclaimed and are now, courtesy of displaying their work with us over the last decade, great friends of the University of Leicester. I would strongly encourage you to visit the show this year, which is free and open until the end of October. Finally, I would like to congratulate you all on the degrees you have obtained and look forward to seeing you at alumni events in future years. But before I close, I would like to tell you about what has become known over the years as the Vice Chancellor's competition. Namely, who can applaud loudest and longest? Now, when I first introduced this, the then Dean of Medicine said to me, well, that's no problem, medicine will win every year. Well, I can tell you, the competition this year is hugely steep, And indeed, we've had all manner of groups in, and we're very much agreed, those of us who've been here every day this week, that you're going to have your work cut out to make sure that this particular degree congregation wins. So what I would like you to do is to join me in showing your appreciation for your parents, relatives, friends and sponsors who have supported you through university. So I would now ask the graduating class of 2011 to join with me in a round of applause for those people. For those of us who've been here this week, I think that's pretty good, but it's not a foregone conclusion. And indeed, I'm highly suspicious that the Dean's been rehearsing you in 5 years. I presume that's why it's a 5-year course. But of course, it's terrific that you should have a really enjoyable time with us this afternoon and have a really enjoyable day. And on behalf of the whole university, I wish you every success in your future lives and careers.
Will all graduands please stand?
By the authority of the Senate, I admit candidates both present and absent to the several degrees for which they are presented.
Well, I haven't been here all week, but that sounded like the winning round to me. So, Mr. Senior Pro Vice Chancellor, as head of the College of Medicine, Biological Sciences and Psychology, I present the following candidates for their degrees. For the degree of Doctor of Medicine, Adam Barlow. Desaline Joseph. Gregory McMahon. Bala Subramanian Sunavasan. For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Adeolu Adewai. Vanessa Terra. Mohammed Alotaibi. Renata Azevedo. Richard Baines. Louise Blakemore. Georgina Bowden. Sophie Bradley. Sophie Bradley. Simon Byrne. Congratulations. Kong Chin. Palminder Dusani. Claudia Fogel. Joe Gesto. Carolyn Hall. Jennifer Higgins. Yan Huang. Benjamin Hunt. Hong Jin. Carla Lopez. Tatiana Moshkovska. Mafalda Damaso. Joanne Kurtz. Luke Richards. Navdeep Sahota. Adrian Stanley. Renata Walowska. Katarzyna Wasiak. Catherine Weber. For the degree of Master of Science in Clinical Sciences, Bernadette Wharton. For the degree of Master of Science in Health Services Research, Joanne Townsend. For the degree of Master of Science in Infection and Immunity, Abu Bakr Gassama. For the degree of Master of Science in Leadership and Management, Alison Burrow-Smith. Christine Southworth. For the degree of Master of Science in Pain Management, Reuben Crossley. Claire Patton. For the degree of Master of Science in Social Science Applied to Health, Kate Hartley. For the degree of Master of Arts in Integrated Provision for Children and Families, Laura Bilbrey. Anne Grandrick. Kay Burke. Rosa Collins. Susan Cook. Susan Cripps. Jill Gallagher. Carla Hendry. Net Saidian. Kathleen Jack. Abnash Kaur. Andrea Lazell. Bernadette Miley. Felicity Norton.
Puna Patalia. Carol Salt. Anke Schulz-Roschwitz. Catherine Smith. Sarah Spall. Wendy Stark. Jacqueline Stevenson. Janet Waller. For the degree of Master of Arts in Social Work, Rachel Bunting. Elspeth Howard. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Biological Sciences, Anne Akeredolu. Sarah Allen. Matthew Alsop. Stella Angeli. Charlotte Bishop. Benjamin Blake. Stephanie Bryan. James Carter. Thomas Cordell. Matt Cockcroft. Matthew Collinson. Winner of the Oxford University Press Achievement in Biosciences Prize, Holly Colvin. Matthew Day. Stuart Dejavin. Mesut Uza Umlioglu. David Fearnley. Winner of the Genetics Prize, Laura Flavel. Stephen Fletcher. Theseus Janarkos. Andrew Gibbs. Susanna Gall. Roger Goss. Jeffrey Grant. Alana Green. Talha Hakim. James Harper. Andrew Higgins. Ashley Hilton. Sundeep Hira. Nicholas Horton. Kelly Horwood. Halima Jabbar. Boaz Jangan. Abigail Johnson. Andrew Jones Reynolds. Michaelis Kutalianu. Carl Out. Chandni Lodia. Rosie Madalezo. Rachel Mansbridge. David Mason. David McVie. Jennifer Morrison. Jane Muyuki. Mirafora Panagi. Dominic Patel. Misha Patel. Christina Futiu. Winner of the Peter Sneath Prize, Amy Ryder. Winner of the May Fund Prize in Biochemistry, Daniel Rogerson. Savannan Sakthivel. Annette Samuel. Amandeep Sanghera. Kia Shafiq Richardson. Jonathan Shand. William Shepherd. Carly Short. Meera Sivan Antharajwe. Winner of the Henry Walter Bates Prize, Keturah Smithson. Mehul Songara. Andrew Taylor. Nital Thanki. Rachel Thomas. Sarah Thompson. Erica Tomlinson. Winner of the May Fund Prize in Biochemistry, the Margaret Wallace Henry Prize, the Departmental Undergraduate Prize, the College of Medicine, Biological Sciences and Psychology Prize, and the Institute of Biology Top Bioscience Student Award, David Turini. Georgette Towolf. Charlotte Walton. Emma Williams. Jack Vishhusen. Wing Wu. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Biological Sciences, European Union, Nicola Burke. Samuel Henderson. Nicole Sims. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Biological Sciences with a year in industry, and winner of the Cell Physiology and Pharmacology Laboratory Prize, Melanie Janaway. Mike J. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Biochemistry, Sugason Ann Palagan. Karishma Aziani. Rudo Chimganda. Sam Craik. Louis Dron. Hannah Ellam. Tamana Hark. Matthew Hevich. Sam Hovell. Balvaj Jagdev. Taviraishi Kaseki. Shamayela Koza. Halima Karoma. Winner of the Alfred Pommons Prize, Pearl Lee. Janet Okoro. Paul Ozergale. Ashley Phillips. Pembe Savas. Jonathan Shaw. Winner of the Medical Biochemistry Prize, Jordan Simmons. Rhiannon Stanton. Arnold Tang. Karika Weldon. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Genetics, Raisa Annam. Hani Bagheri. Ajaya Bogal Todd. Nathan Bowman. Hussein Chagsin. Anamika Chowdhury. Vivian Chu. Richard Davey. Paki Deviran. Vivian Igba. Lindsay Fernandez. Gorpreet Gataoya. Winner of the Medical Genetics Prize, Thomas Green. Laura McCulloch. Mitul Mazuria. Natalie Menick. Aiba Momo. Gareth Moore. James Newton. Rachel Ormerod. Anthony Solanke. Sarah Spurgeon. Haze Sutku. Logan Titchmarsh. Hassanali Walji. Daniel Webb. Alexander Willett. Hassamim Youssef. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Genetics, European Union, Catherine Brown. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Genetics with a year in industry, Katie Baldwin. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Physiology, Mareen Alam. Manpreet Bauer. Amelia Byrne. Joanna B. James Brown. Chi Cho. Winner of the Physiological Society Undergraduate Prize, the Novartis Best Student in Third Year Pharmacology Prize, the Novartis Best Student in Second Year Modules BS2013 and BS2014 Prize, and the Departmental Medical Physiology Prize. Natasha Clayton. Michelle Donison. Nori Dowlett. Rebecca Elliott. Rebecca Fairfield. Winner of the Novartis Best Student in Second Year Module BS2014 Prize, Harriet Fowler. Stebby Ganeshamorthy. Billy Hawkins. Gemma Hawkins. Krishni Kangatharan. Teresa Kapasova. Meenal Kavavadra. Thomas Knights. Avril Newman. Matthew Nichols. Asha Pardia. Emma Quaintrell. Lucy Sanders. Natasha Somani. Winner of the Cell Physiology and Pharmacology Library Project Prize, Barbara Emily Treguna. Amy Vincent. Mohammed Wasim. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Physiology, European Union, Robert Kay. For the intercalated degree of Bachelor of Science, Krish Ananthan Abalawana. Winner of the Bert Thurston Prize, Niraj Barot. Christopher Bastian Pillai. Winner of the Ballantine Prize, Lucy Bation. Kanai Gavala. Ravi Galani. Samir Hussein. Winner of the Keeler Prize, Pavitra Jaya Ramahandran. Vikram Jayagopal. Kim Lee. Aretha Maya. Edward Morgan. Mohammed Mughal. Ravi Narang. Rikesh Patel. Talia Paracha. Harish Selvaskanda. Mark Sims. Niarika Tiagi. Patrick Walsh. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Genetics, Jessica Abhulimen.
The nominee for the award of a University Teaching Fellowship will be presented by the Pro Vice-Chancellor, Christine Fife.
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I present to you this academic colleague who has been nominated for the award of a University Teaching Fellowship for 2011. In recognition of his innovative curricular developments at undergraduate and postgraduate levels in the Department of Biology, Dr. David Harper.
David, they clearly appreciate it greatly. Many congratulations.
The nominee for a Teaching Partnership Award will also be made by the Pro Vice-Chancellor.
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I present to you this student who has been nominated for a Teaching Partnership Award in 2011. In recognition of his exceptional contribution to peer-led education and student support in the School of Medicine, Mervyn Thomas.
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I present the following candidates for their degrees. For the degree of Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery, Mohammed Abdullah. Rika Agnihotri.
Congratulations.
Sabir Ahmed. Zahia Ahmed.
Congratulations.
Mohammed Ajmal.
Congratulations.
Helal Ali.
Congratulations.
Sarah Ali.
Congratulations. Thank
you. Orlando Allen.
Congratulations.
Nahid Anwar. Hussein Askarali.
Congratulations.
Aaron Almir.
Congratulations.
Andrew Aziz.
Congratulations.
Mohammed Bahaudin.
Congratulations.
Abigail Bailey.
Congratulations.
Amy Barker. Valerie Barlow.
Congratulations.
Mandeep Bedi.
Congratulations.
Safina Begum.
Congratulations.
Amrit Balaru.
Congratulations.
Gabriella Bidwell.
Congratulations.
Stephen Blake. Sean Bullough.
Congratulations.
Emily Carmona.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Charles Lawson Prize, the Smith, Klein and French Prize, and the Amir Ghulam Hussein Prize for dissection, Samantha Chamberlain.
Congratulations.
Rachel Chanda.
Congratulations.
Claire Chappell.
Congratulations.
Winner of the AstraZeneca Prize, Meetam Chauhan.
Congratulations.
Vishnuzai Chauhan.
Congratulations.
Vijay Chavda. Nantanit Shyamcharo Envut.
Congratulations.
Katriona Charoji.
Congratulations.
Jason Clark.
Congratulations.
Winner of the John and Hillary Hernshaw Diabetes Prize, James Coleman. Alice Connellon.
Congratulations.
Andrew Connery.
Congratulations.
Chloe Corlett.
Congratulations.
John Crawford.
Congratulations.
Carla Cudmore.
Congratulations.
Kate Dawson. Alistair Deckiam.
Congratulations.
Rekha Desol.
Congratulations.
Andrew Daytrick.
Congratulations.
Nikki Dineen.
Congratulations.
James Dixon. Winner of the AstraZeneca Prize, Samiksha Dogra.
Congratulations.
Tolilopi Doherty.
Congratulations.
Ella Zora.
Congratulations.
Simon Ellis.
Congratulations.
Richard Ellison. Jessica Evans.
Congratulations.
Andrew Thackeray.
Congratulations.
Mark Fernando.
Congratulations.
Sarah Freshney.
Congratulations.
Helen Fry.
Congratulations.
Victoria Fulbrook. Fiona Gallagher.
Congratulations.
Kimberly Gard.
Congratulations.
Noliana Ghazali.
Congratulations.
William Gibbs.
Congratulations.
Adam Goodchild.
Congratulations.
Louisa Grady. Rebecca Gribbett.
Congratulations.
Safwan Hafez.
Congratulations.
Peter Hampson.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Aziz Hark.
Congratulations.
Jennifer Hayes.
Congratulations.
Samuel Hartley. Nisreen Hathiari. Melinda Howe.
Congratulations.
Natalie Hayes.
Congratulations.
Winner of the BMA Prize for Clinical Excellence, Ruth Heatherly. Heaven via here. Olivia Herbert. Anna Hodgson. Stephen Hollier Cox. Edward Holloway. Duncan Hughes. Peter Hughes. Liaquat Hussein. Jennifer Hutchinson. Sarah Hyde. Winner of the Just Fair Trade Prize, Ramez Ibrahim. Marvash Ilyas. Harriet Ng. Adnan Iqbal. Winner of the Arthur Watts Prize in Clinical Methods and the Very Reverend Derek Hole Prize, Judith Jade. Archana Jaitka.
Congratulations.
Ariant Jain.
Congratulations.
Niran Veer Jaspal.
Congratulations.
Donna Jolly Chen.
Congratulations.
Martin Jones. Winner of the Carl Zeiss Prize and the Treseda Prize, Timothy Jones. Winner of the Frank Harris Prize, Akshay Kansagra. Naomi Kaufman. Ramanjit Kaur. Dylan Kay. Winner of the Sir Robert Kilpatrick Prize and the Nephrology Prize, Robin Kendall. Sarah Kenyon Ellis. Ahmed Khan. Rebecca King. Gina Kothari. Winner of the Medical Women's Federation East Midlands Prize, Ratna Kothari. Samuel Krauser. Amritpal Kundra. Winner of the Sydney Brandon Prize and Medal in Psychiatry, Bansri Lakhani. David Lamb. James Lever. Jun Lee. Quinn Lee. Amanda Lewis Evans.
Congratulations.
Catherine Ling.
Congratulations.
Kim Fluellen Jones. Bethany Mackay. Syed Mahmoud. Irshad Mohammed. Vizita Majistia. Kaushik Makam. Amane Mamoon. Winner of the AstraZeneca Prize, Yvette Martin. Nida Assis. Christopher McCauley. Nicole McGrath. Winner of the Faculty Prize, Charlene McInnes. Paul Meacher. Konstantinos Megisidis. Shanine Megi. Mai Hazizi. Ijeoma Mezu. Winner of the Pfizer Microbiology Prize, Anita Mitra. Diana Rafik. Amira Vazali. Catherine Mooney. Jennifer Murphy. Ebrahim Mutvali. AJ Knight. Natasha Nati. Rufava Ndekweva. Peter Newman. Stephen Norris. Helen Ord. Laura Asuji. Alice Overbury. Nadia Patel. Michael Patrick. Winner of the Philip Hammersley Gold Medal, Charlotte Payne. Rebecca Payne. Winner of the Arthritis and Rheumatism Prize and the John McVicar Prize and Medal, Javiera Peracha. Winner of the John and Hilary Hernshaw Diabetes Prize, Simon Phillips. Bhavna Petrula. Matthew Player. Cooper Popat. Louise Potter. Vikram Puri. Bushra Rabani. Shalini Rajkumar. Ian Randall. Osman Riaz. James Roberts. Jennifer Roberts. William Robertson. Jamie Robinson. Alexander Rose. Winner of the AstraZeneca Prize, Charlotte Rothwell. Sarah Rushton. Pantea Sabah. Arusha Safari.
Thank you.
Shazava Saith.
Congratulations.
Bina Salhan.
Congratulations.
Sundeep Sarai.
Congratulations.
Leela Syed.
Congratulations.
Clara Sarekia.
Congratulations.
Anna Severite. Rizwana Shafiq. Savita Shajpal. Raunak Singh. Vaisnavi Sivithavan. Daniel Skinner. Alistair Smith. Anna Snowden. Sabiva Somani. Ashley Squires. Alison Standridge. David Stedman. Agnieszka Strelzak. Baldeep Sayan. Yasmin Tabak. Winner of the AstraZeneca Prize, Yihu Tan. Davinda Tagali. Selina Thakma. Daniel Thomas. Rachel Tricky. Sonal Tripathi. Samuel Tromans. Elizabeth Turner. Sarah Upperton. Amit Verma. Philip Vermeeren. Kumaralingam Vijay Avamon. Kuvam Rahid. Kylie Walker. Carmel Webb. Thomas Weldon. Alistair Wills. Sana Yazdani. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I now invite a representative of those whom you have admitted today to the degrees of Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery to come forward to the platform in order that you may lead them in the affirmation of the Declaration of Geneva.
Will graduates in the degrees of Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery please stand?
At the time of being admitted as a member of the medical profession, I solemnly pledge myself to consecrate my life to the service of humanity. I will give to my teachers the respect and gratitude which is their due. I will practice my profession with conscience and dignity. The health of my patient will be my first consideration. I will respect the secrets which are confided in me even after the patient has died. I will maintain by all means in my power the honour and the noble traditions of the medical profession. My colleagues will be my brothers and my sisters. I will not permit consideration of religion, nationality, race, politics, or social standing to intervene between my duty and patients. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life from its beginning, even under threat, and I will not use my medical knowledge contrary to the laws of humanity. I make these promises solemnly, freely, and upon thy honour.
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, distinguished guests, Leicester graduates, your families and friends. As Senior Pro Vice-Chancellor, it is both an honour and a pleasure to be able to add my congratulations to those given by the Vice-Chancellor and Archbishop Desmond Tutu to the graduating class of 2011. For you, the graduating class of 2011, this emphatically is your day. The annual degree ceremonies which we hold are very special occasions. They are opportunities for you to celebrate your graduation, not only with your families and friends, but also with the staff of the university, who take considerable pride in your achievements. You have worked hard to achieve your success, and you should be very proud of what you have accomplished. We very much hope that you will keep in touch with us over the years to come. You are all representatives of the College of Medicine, Biological Sciences and Psychology, and it is good to see how many of the academic staff from this college are here today to celebrate with you. Indeed, it occurs to me that such is the array of medical talent assembled behind me that should anyone have the misfortune to fall ill, I can't think of a better place for us to be. Some of you graduating today are postgraduates, and others are receiving your first bachelor's degrees. For those of you who are receiving postgraduate degrees, you are part of a very large postgraduate community. Currently, the university has over 23,000 students, and of this number, just over half are postgraduates. This is one of the distinctive features and strengths of the University of Leicester. Few, if any, other universities have such a high population of postgraduates. Another feature of this university is the diversity of background of our students. Our graduates come from all over the world, proving that Leicester is truly a global university. The discipline you've shown in completing your courses and the knowledge and skills you've acquired will stand you in good stead for the future. This is also true for those of you who've completed undergraduate degrees. Reading for any degree at a university is very much a case of directed self-tuition. You are taught by leading researchers in their fields. This teaching, however, is to provide you with a roadmap for further learning. Much of what you then do is to follow this map through your own endeavours and, to introduce a new metaphor, to put flesh on the skeleton provided by the academic staff. As you then pursue your independent study, write assignments and take part in laboratory work and small group discussions, your subjects come alive. But your contribution to the learning process is a two-way street. You may be surprised, but it is true, that your tutors learn a great deal from you. This is one of the attractions of working and studying at the University of Leicester. While we are a research-intensive university, we also believe strongly in the synergy between research and teaching. The tuition provided by leading exponents of their disciplines enables the staff to share their expertise and convey their enthusiasm for their subjects. In return, your own thoughts and insights and questions can prompt us to rethink our own views and in the process further our own developments. All of you, whether postgraduates or undergraduates, have been studying in the related fields of biological sciences and medicine. It's a strength of the university that complementary subjects are housed under the same organisational roof, thus strengthening the links between basic and translational science. As you progress through your time at Leicester, in addition to the development of your scientific knowledge, you have also developed various skills and values, not the least of which is the facility for independence and critical thought. These values are of great importance whether you are practicing medicine or pursuing other careers. Another important characteristic which unites you as a group is that you are all now graduates of the University of Leicester, one of the best universities in the country. That this is a leading university has been recognised over the years by its consistently high placings in the league tables and its reception and its receipt of the award of University of the Year in 2008-09. Being a graduate of this university is a badge of distinction which you can wear with pride for the rest of your lives. Moreover, as Leicester graduates, you'll continue to be ambassadors of this institution, and as such, you represent one of our greatest assets. Shortly after being asked to give this closing address, I told my partner and dinner companion that I was going to be doing this. She thought for a while, smiled, wrote something on the menu, and then passed it over to me. I looked down and saw she'd written on it the letters K-I-S-S, kiss. So I smiled, leaned forward, and she said, "No, what I mean is keep it short, stupid." So, mindful of that injunction, and knowing you're keen to rejoin your families and friends, I shall bring my remarks to a close. The university sector is about to go through an extremely challenging period as we come to terms with a new funding system. Clearly, it's also a challenging time for you, our graduates, as you seek to make your way through the world. With the qualities which you've demonstrated in achieving the various degrees that you have, you are supremely well qualified to meet those challenges and succeed in your ambitions. I have every confidence that in a very difficult world, you will fare well and bring credit on yourselves and your university, a university which takes great pride in you. As an unreconstructed fan of the earliest series of Star Trek, I conclude with the famous words of Mr. Spock, "Live long and prosper," to which I would add, "Be happy." I offer you my warmest congratulations on your achievements and my very best wishes for the future. Thank you very much.
Well, this brings us to the end of the proceedings for this afternoon, and indeed to the end of the proceedings for the summer degree congregations in this university this year. I'm sure that you would like to join with me in thanking a number of people who are hiding behind those doors across there
and they'll come in a moment or two, but they are the members of corporate services who really work very hard in order to ensure that these degree ceremonies work really successfully. And also there are many people in estates, in the gardens, who contribute to the whole thing being an absolute success. So I'd like you to show your thanks on behalf of not only yourselves, but also all the Leicester graduates that have gone through the ceremonies this year. Now, clearly, you've demonstrated that you've enjoyed the ceremonies today, and we hope that over the years you will cheer the university on in all that it does. Certainly, the better we do in the University of Leicester, the greater the value of the degree that you take away with you today. We hope that some of you will want to come back to the university for periods of postgraduate study throughout your careers, and I hope that this is the beginning of a long-term relationship with the university and that we shall see you on many occasions, socially and also academically. Indeed, in the various professions that you join, you can be very proud of your university, and only recently I was at a reception with recent graduates of the university from the last 5 years, who all were very happy to tell me how much their employers hold a qualification from the University of Leicester in such high regard, and compare us with other top-ranking universities in the UK. Now, as I've said, you know, we want you to cheer us on, and obviously, at the beginning of the afternoon, you demonstrated you were, pretty good, and I would think you've done that all the afternoon. And I just want to make absolutely certain that you are absolutely the best people at applauding this year. So one more round of applause for all the graduates. I now declare this congregation closed.